Welcome to Data Science 1, Probability Equally Likely Approach. Okay, so you remember from the previous videos that we've talked about what a sample space and events are. These are the outcomes that can occur. All the outcomes are in S, and the events are combinations of outcomes. And we've denoted the probability of an event by P of E. And one way to get this calculation is to look at the proportion of the time an event was observed. So I would count how many times I saw it over how many times I tried to see it. And this P hat will show that the probability is basically data driven. And that's what empirical probability means, is data driven. And this approach is really good, except that it's really time consuming in an experiment and possibly not be able to do something. For example, if you're destructive testing something, you can't really do a whole lot of these before you've wiped out everything. All right, but in this experiment, we have to observe things and count them. So the key is you have to observe. Now, what if we could do an alternative to it? So an alternative approach is to consider experiments where each outcome is equally likely, and then use that property to create the probabilities of events. And this works for many simple experiments, and it turns out that you can turn them into more complicated ones. Since the outcomes are equally likely, we don't need to actually conduct the experiment. We're going to assume that they're equally likely. That way we can get around actually having to perform the experiment at all. However, we still need to be able to account basically how many types of ways things can occur. And I'll put here, this can be complicated, way more complicated than you would think. Okay, so here's a simple example. Lots of board games are out there. People play them, and you use one or more dice, right? You'd have a dice that has six sides on it, typically, because it's a cube. And what we're looking at is this sample space here, and I can just list out what each of the items are. There's a dice that has one side with one dot on it, a side that has two dots on it, a side that has three dots on it, a side that has four dots on it, a side that has five dots on it, and a side that has six dots on it. So when I roll this, the one that is facing upwards is my outcome. And if the dice is considered fair, then each face is equally likely to be facing upwards after you roll it. So since there are only six outcomes and they're all equally likely, as each face has a probability of 1/6 of facing upwards after a roll. So the probability of one is equal to the probability of two, equal to the probability of three, equal to the probability of four, equal to the probability of five, equal to the probability of six. And all of these probabilities are equal to 1/6. Okay, so that's what equally likely means. They're all the same probability. Okay, so if we're interested in the probability of an event, we need to count the number of outcomes in the event as well as the number of outcomes in the sample space. So we're going to let this double bar denote the number of outcomes in some event or set, and I called it dot. So we're going to have this dot here. And this way we can define the probability of an event E to be, the probability of E is the number of events or outcomes inside event E over all the possible outcomes of my experiment. Now this formula only works if all the outcomes in S are equally likely. If they're not, then you have to work around it. Also needs us to count these, right? It counts the number of outcomes in the event and the number of outcomes in S. So let's go back to our simple example. Suppose I'm playing a simple board game with my daughter, and I am in the position of, if I roll a single dice and get either a one or a four, then I can stay in the game. Otherwise, she wins the game. What is the probability that I stay in the game after the next roll? Well, what does it mean to stay in the game? Well, I would roll a one or a four. Okay, how many options do I have for this? This has two in it. Here, if I look at this, there are only six possibilities of what can occur. So if I look at the probability of E, which is I stay in the game, which also corresponds to rolling these two faces, it was probability of E over the number of outcomes in E over the number of outcomes in S. If we look, here's our outcomes, and you see that there's two up here, six down here, so it's 1/3. Thus, the probability that I stay in the game is 1/3. to use empirical probability, I would have to roll the dice many, 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 many times and record the number of times that either one or four showed up. And this approach, notice, we didn't even roll the dice once. We just thought about it. Okay, so let's get a little more complicated. What if I had two dice? Okay, when you have two dice, everything gets more complicated. Now, to make things easier to understand, suppose I have one die that is blue and another die that is red. Then this is what our sample space looks like. Okay, a 1-1, one on the blue, one on the red. And then we have 2-1, two on the blue, one on the red, versus one on the blue and two on the red. Okay, so, and this goes across all the possible ones here that are listed, and there are 36 possible outcomes, okay? So if you were to list these all out, there's 36 possible outcomes. And notice that you have to think about this. It's really not that hard, and we'll get more to how to count later, but I want to show you that just doing the simple thing of adding an extra die to your game seriously complicated the sample space, okay? And also, that means that the outcome space is going to be complicated as well. So, suppose I'm playing a game with my daughter and I need a 4 or an 8 to stay in the game. What is the probability I stay in the game after the next roll, okay? So, how many ways can I get a 4? Well, a 1 and a 3, a 2 and a 2, a 3 and a 1. That's how the only ways I can get a 4. What about an 8? Well, there's 2 and 6, 3 and 5, 4 and 4, 5 and 3, 6 and 2. Those are the only ways that I can get an 8. So if I counted all these up, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 outcomes in this group. So here, if we were interested in this probability, we take the number of outcomes in E over the number of outcomes in S, which is 8 over 36, or 2/9, which is approximately 0.2222. So there's only a 22% chance that I'm going to stay in the game. All right, so relative frequency approach to probability is one way to assign probabilities to event. It requires each outcome to be equally likely, and it requires the ability to count all the outcomes in the sample space and the event space. Okay, it's cheaper than actually running the experiments over and over, and in order to be successful, we need to learn how to count, and that's what some of the later videos are going to be about. It's really going to focus in on being able to count. The next couple videos are going to be talking about properties of probabilities and things that we need to know to be able to really deal with probabilities in an effective manner. And I'll see you there.